the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
Greetings, I'm Reverend Dr. John E. Jackson, Sr., and I'm the senior pastor of the Trinity United Church of Christ in the great city of Gary, Indiana, where we are not just another church, but we are a culturally conscious, Christ-centered church committed to the community. We are unashamedly Black, and we are unapologetically Christian.
Hi everyone, my name is Jonathan, and I am a member of Trinity United Church of Christ in the great city of Gary, Indiana, where we are not just another church, but a culturally conscious, Christ-centered church that is committed to the community. And I want to welcome you all to our great virtual worship experience. Please know that whether you are a member or a guest, we thank God for you, and we will be praying for you every step of the way. So come on. Let's worship.
Don't ever
depart.
get better.
Greetings, TUCC Church family. I'm Reverend Charles Docker, and I'm here with the TUCC Gary announcements for this week. We thank those who have joined us virtually today, be that by Facebook or YouTube. To God be the glory for each of you. Please subscribe to YouTube. We are trying to reach 1,000 subscribers, so please share this and subscribe today. Continue to tune in to our stream services on YouTube and Facebook Live and participate in our digital evangelism by sharing our streamed events with others. And beloved, we want to thank you for being so faithful in your giving. You are keeping your church strong in this time of crisis. Please continue to give and bless our congregation. We don't know how long, but if you continue to give, we will hold out. Thank you again for all your gifts, all your tithes, all your offerings. Don't forget that we have several ways to give. You can download the app Trinity United Church of Christ. Go to the App Store and look for Trinity United Church of Christ Gary app. Hit download. You can give directly through the website at www.tuccgary.org. And finally, you can mail or drop off your offering right here in the church mailbox, and we will get it. But please, please give. We are going to see if we can open the church for safe, social distance, mask-wearing worship on the 1st of May. We're asking God for discernment to give us a word to let us know, is it safe to do this? Please pray and please plan to get vaccinated. Please plan to get vaccinated. For those of you who are eligible, have you scheduled your vaccine yet? Please note, Indiana, all over the age of 16 can now be vaccinated. We encourage you to go get vaccinated because it's the only way that we can eliminate the coronavirus and return to safe gathering again. Thank you. The Surviving the Storm COVID-19 Support Group Ministry meets every first and third Saturday at 8 o'clock a.m. via Zoom. It's facilitated by myself, Reverend Charles Dockery. This is a support group for those who have had to deal with the positive diagnosis of coronavirus and for those caretaking for someone with a positive diagnosis of coronavirus. This support group is also for those who have not received a positive diagnosis but who have been struggling to survive this pandemic itself. And finally, this support group is for anyone who has been affected by coronavirus, and that's everyone. So this ministry is for everyone. Please tune in every Thursday to Theology Thursday. We're back. We hope you will tune in each Thursday from 1 o'clock to 2:30 on Facebook Live. Please join us for this in-depth discussion on how theology shapes our lives. And don't forget the Tuesday Bible classes. There is a new time, for the month of April, and that time is 12 o'clock for the month of April only. And I will be facilitating for Pastor while he's on a well-deserved vacation. We are on from 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock each Tuesday afternoon for the month of April. Did I say we're on 12 o'clock for the month of April via Facebook and YouTube? Please join us. We also have an Instagram page, and that's TUCCGary2, TUCCGary2, and a Twitter page, Trinity UCC Gary, or at TUCC Gary. Please connect with us through all our social media outlets. And finally, we're having a mobile food giveaway on Saturday, April the 24th, from 10 o'clock until 1 o'clock, or while supplies last. Volunteers are needed. We thank you so much. And these are your TUCC Gary announcements for this week.
Greetings, church family. I'm Reverend Emmett Carl Mosley, and these are the prayer concerns. We have a number of prayer concerns, and we just ask that you pray. Pray for Bobby Wooten. He has health challenges. Robert Gordon, the health of his brothers, Willie and Stanley Gordon, and his nephew, Nyjah, Rosenborough. Continue to pray for Pastor and Janice Jackson, daughter-in-law, Denise. Please pray for her husband, John Jr., and the entire family. Continue to pray for Pastor Jackson's nephew, Michael Lewis. Continue to pray for Charles Ware, who has a number of health challenges. Do have a praise report, though. Praise report. Tests have come back negative in the heart and the neck. Continue to pray for Diane Ware and the family. They are looking for closure to the murder of her sister, Elector Peterson. Kathy Hodgkins and son David, they have health challenges. Please pray for them. Mother Inez Jones, recovering, unbelievable person. Continue to pray for her, though. Theron Mays, nephew of Maxine Brown. He is in constant pain for Parkinson's disease. That's a tough disease, but pray for him. Continue prayer for Deacon Phyllis Drayton, recovering from surgery. Deacon Chris Yates, health challenges. Continue pray for his wife also, Adrian Yates, as a caregiver. Major responsibility. Greg Holly, brother of Emily Coates, recovering. Mother of Dr. Bahura, Mrs. Azy Williams, Jareen Reed, Lillian Wilkerson, Pat Alexander, Olivia Meredith, Deborah Rowe and her daughter, Jacqueline, major health challenges, but major victories also. Cheryl Carson, Alicia Cotton, Raymond Della Pinta, Mary Henry, Alonzo and Ted McCoy, Kyle Taylor, Kathleen Harris, Linda Lyons, Garcinia White, Trish Thorne, Ryan Thorne, and her nephew Isaiah, the father of Maisha Logan. Continue to stay in prayer for them. There's been a lot of hospitalization. Our own Rodney Mumphrey, he's home. He's surviving the storm of COVID-19. Many of us have been impacted by that. Peyton, granddaughter of Deborah Rowe, recovering from another surgery. She has had major surgery, but she is a trooper. Marvin Cole, recovering from surgery. James Knight, recovering from surgery. Ruth Wilson, recovering from surgery. These are victories, all right? But also we've had bereavement. We've been touched by the power that still belongs to God. Woody Favors family, uncle of Pastor Jackson and the last living brother of Mother Eleanor Jackson. Dean Martin, brother of Connie Martin and son of Susie Martin. Family of Lillian Wilkerson, Deacon Canova Matthews. Willie Wallace family, we're still in prayer, continual prayer. We don't stop praying here. Betty and Kathleen and Marika. And don't forget Marvin Aiken's family, Myra and Marshall. You know, time heals, but stay in prayer for the folks that have been touched by all of these things related to medical issues, but also just spiritual issues, because we need strength. Please join us virtually at the throne of grace. It's time for prayer, church. And we know that prayer works. I'm a living witness that it works. If someone just says, I'm going to choose someone on this list, I'm going to really get serious about praying for them, I just know things can happen. So let us pray, oh God. First of all, God, we come acknowledging that you are God and above you there is none. We acknowledge your power. We acknowledge that you're everywhere at the same time. God, we acknowledge that you know everything, oh God. You know what our heart desire is. You know what's in our mind, oh God. And we look to you knowing that you can do everything. We don't know how you do it, God, but we know that you're the creator of the universe, oh God. There is no lack in you, oh God. There is hope in you, oh God. Because, Lord, we don't know what the future is going to bring, but, God, we know who holds our future. Oh, God, we look to you right now. God, for everyone whose name we have called out, but all those who've been thinking, oh, God, thinking about their loved ones, thinking about the people that they care about, oh, Lord, think about the people that they work with, think about the person that guide us in our government, God. Those people need you too. They can't live without you, God. They can't make without you. So we lean on you, God. We lean on you on behalf of all those who are in nursing homes and hospitals, oh God, that we haven't called their names, but they're there, Lord. And because of this pandemic, oh God, that you allow, oh God, through your power, God, because we know you can stop it any second. At any time, you can stop it, God, and we lean on you, God. We don't know everything. We don't know anything compared to what you know, but, God, we know that you're in charge. You're in control, so right now, touch in a mighty way, God. Everyone who's been touched by all these medical challenges, oh, God. God, sometimes you walk around, and God, people think there's nothing wrong, but, God, you know everything about us. So right now, God, touch in a mighty way. Prepare our hearts and minds to continue to reflect on you, to rely on you. So God, right now, in the name of Jesus, we pray. God, we're not full of ourselves, oh God. But right now, God, we're full of you. We're full of all the power and the hope that we have in you to touch this world. God, we're clamoring for all kinds of remedies, oh God, but we know the most important remedy is you. So we lean on you, God, right now. God, we're not thinking about ourselves. We're thinking about the power that you hold in your hand. And Lord, we love you. We can't do without you. We don't want to try to do without you. God, carry us on today, this week, oh God, this month, oh God, this year. Let this year be a year of overcoming all obstacles that we've been faced with, Lord. We love you, God, and we pray right now that we lean on one another, God. Don't try to lean on the world, but lean on one another and lean on you, knowing that you have the victory. And we claim the victory right now. In the mighty, matchless name of Jesus, we pray. And we say hallelujah, amen, and we count the victory right now. Amen.
Although the Lord said all things would work together for good, it never promised that all things would be good. But we do have a promise. A promise that simply says,
no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Hey, yes, and it won't work. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord will lift up a standard against him, and he won't prosper. No, 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 no. Ain't wanna work. Say no weapon.
If I could get somebody to stand with me tonight and declare that no weapon formed against me is gonna prosper. No weapon formed against your home. No weapon formed against your children. Say
it won't work. No weapon formed against me. Yeah.
the snares sent by your enemies, cause they ain't gonna work, no, 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 no. You've been lied on, cheated, talked about, mistreated, but God has got your back and he's gonna hook you up. Oh yeah. How many weapons formed against you? Sister, how many of them gonna prosper? Say, how many of them gonna get you? Yeah. If you lose your job, say, and you don't know how you're gonna pay your bills, say, Lord, you never let me down before. I know it looks tight right now, but I trust you. Praise the Lord like you're crazy. Let me tell you why. Because see, while you clapping your hands and the devil is wreaking havoc in your home, this confuses the enemy. That's because you're not praising him because of what's going on. You're praising him because you know the outcome is you win. You win because your heavenly Father is getting ready to jump up in this.
Good morning, beloved. I am so excited to stand before you in these moments and deliver our sermon for today. While our pastor is on sabbatical, we celebrate him and his wonderful ministry during this time, especially during our pandemics of COVID-19 and police brutality. I thank God for him being the shepherd of this flock. And so we celebrate his time to rest, because he deserves it. Beloved, I won't be before you long. Please turn to Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17. Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17. No weapon that is fashioned against you shall prosper, and you shall confute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, says the Lord. Again, I like to read that again. I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version, a passage that we often hear time and time again. Isaiah 54, 17, no weapon that is fashioned against you shall prosper, and you shall confute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, says the Lord. For all of those who need a sermon, a title for our time together, here it is: Dealing with WTH Moments. dealing with WTH moments. Dealing with WTH moments. And what does WTH stand for? Oh, thank you so much for asking in the virtual audience today. WTH stands for Weapons, Tongues, and Heritage. Weapons, Tongues, and Heritage. What do you think I was referring to? Dealing with WTH moments. No weapon that is fashioned against you shall prosper. Verse 17 in this text tells us something that we didn't know. Verse 17 in this text tells us something that we often don't pay attention to. Verse 17 in this text tells us something that we look past and don't give a much hermeneutical suspicion to. Verse 17 lets us know, no weapon that is fashioned against you shall prosper, which means first and foremost, weapons exist. The text tells us no weapons formed against you shall prosper, but it never says weapons will never form. Nope, that's not what the text tells us. The text teaches us that weapons will be formed. Sometimes we preach an inaccurate theology, which suggests that chaos and conflict can be avoided, that you can make certain decisions in life that won't cause you any pain, that surrounding yourself with the right people at all times will automatically keep you from experiencing difficulty and defeat. But this Isaiah 54 text teaches us that weapons will form. The reflective question for us today, family, is, can you learn to find peace even when weapons surround you and are pointed directly at you? Oh, do you have the capacity to rest comfortably sitting in chaos and conflict? What is the good news in this text for us today? The good news is, even though weapons will form, our text says they won't prosper. Oh, that is enough to shout and say hallelujah. That's enough to thank Jesus. That's enough to give God some praise. But interestingly, beloved, we have to examine, what do weapons look like? Weapons are more than simply instruments used in wars to physically attack people. Sometimes weapons are created and crafted to psychologically attack people in their mind. Some weapons are created and crafted to spiritually attack people in their spirit or their being. What you talking about, Danielle? Oh, I'm so glad you asked. When we intentionally and methodically built statues of white men to center whiteness, these are called weapons that have been formed against people of color. But the good news is, these weapons won't prosper. When we create an entire criminal justice system centered on racism, this is called a weapon, that has been formed to police black bodies. But the good news is, these weapons won't prosper. When we intentionally use the Bible to hurt people and separate some people from the love of God, this is called a weapon that has been formed to exclude certain folks. But the good news is, these weapons won't prosper. Ah, weapons will form. No matter how good you are in life, no matter how often you go to church, no matter how often you participate in social justice ministry, weapons will form. But the good news is they won't prosper. This text also reminds us that not all weapons formed against you are created by other people. Can I say that one more time, beloved? Not all weapons formed against you are created by other people. If we're honest with ourselves, sometimes the weapons formed against ourself have been handcrafted by ourself. I didn't do better because I didn't believe I was deserving of better. I didn't reach higher because I didn't believe I was deserving of higher. I didn't strive for more because I didn't believe I was deserving of more. Make sure that you are not the weapon formed against yourself. Some people call that self-sabotage. Others call that internalized oppression. What's the good news for us today? Even in the midst of all of the weapons that we form against ourselves, even these weapons won't prosper. When I think of all the silly things I used to do, when I think of all of the crazy situations I would find myself in, when I think about all the people I used to keep company with that I had no business keeping company with, when I think about the goodness of God's graciousness and mercifulness to protect me and keep even myself from prospering against myself, you get that tomorrow, that's enough to praise God. That's enough to shout, thank you, Jesus. Is there anybody here who knows how to praise God and thank God that the situations, the people, the events that you caused didn't prosper into long-term consequences against yourself? This text also tells us that even though it is in fact the case that weapons form, no weapon that is fashioned against us shall prosper. And the second part of this text is, and you shall confute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. Oftentimes, beloved, when we quote this scripture, we don't go forward and quote the rest of it. We have turned the first part of the scripture into a superficial cliche. No weapons formed against you shall prosper. But I like the second part of this text a little bit more. And you shall confute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. What does the second half of this scripture tell us? The second half of the scripture tells us when people can't physically hurt you with their physical weapons, then they will try to verbally hurt you with their verbal weapons. The tongue, as my grandmother used to say, a power of life and death is in the tongue. Beloved, just as weapons will form against you, Isaiah, this prophetic one, teaches us that tongues will also rise up against you. But the good news is you will be vindicated. I don't know who needs to hear this, but someone's been feeling down and out because folks been talking about you. Ah, talking about you on your job. Oh, talking about you in your family. Oh, even talking about you in the church. But the good news is even those tongues will not prosper. The good news is you will be vindicated by the Lord. So, what's the reflective message that you must remember on today? Not only will weapons rise up against you, but won't prosper, but even tongues will start to rise up against you, but even those things shall not prosper. So it must become apparent and evident to you that some voices you must learn to ignore. Watch this. Even when that one voice is the only voice talking, you have to be careful that you don't start to internalize that voice. When Jesus was tempted into the wilderness, led into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit, then tempted by the devil. You remember that story after being baptized, Jesus is led into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit and the devil tempts him. It was the devil's one and only voice that was talking to Jesus while Jesus was in his wilderness experience, and Jesus had to ignore this one and only voice. Oh, unfortunately, Isaiah reminds us that there are difficult times in your life when only one voice is talking, but sometimes you have to ignore that voice. When that one voice tells you you're not worthy of all that God has for you, you have to remind yourself, I may be black, I may be poor, I may be ugly, but I'm still here. When that one voice tells you that you can't amount to anything, that your mother was this and your daddy was this and you will never be anything or achieve anything in life, you have to remind yourself, you is smart, you is kind, you is important. Oh, when that one voice tells you that you cannot survive unless you stay in relationship with them, you have to remind yourself, at first I was afraid. I was petrified. Kept thinking I could never live without you by my side. But then I spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong, and I grew strong and I learned how to get along. So now you're back from outer space. I just walked in to find you here with that sad look on your face. I should have changed that stupid lock. I should have made you leave your key. If I had known for just 1 second, you'd be back to bother me. Go on, not go. Walk out the door. Just turn around now, because you're not welcome anymore. Weren't you the one who tried to hurt me with goodbye? Did you think I'd crumble? Did you think I'd lay down and die? Oh, no, not I. I will survive. Oh, as long as I know how to love, I know I'll stay alive, because I've got all my life to live and I've got all my love to give. And I will survive. I will survive. Hey. I'm so happy you've heard that hymn too. Last but not least, this text teaches us that yes, weapons will form against you, but they will not prosper. And yes, you shall confute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. But last but not least, and this is the best part of this scripture, get ready, family. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, says the Lord. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, says the Lord. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, says the Lord. Heritage, heritage, heritage. We come from an African people who had to rely on the spirit of a God who would protect them even in the face of extreme racism, even in the face of extreme capitalism, even in the face, family of being kidnapped from their own home, brought to a completely different country, continent, land, and forced to work for nearly 400 years under brutal, harsh conditions, suffering separations from biological family members on an auction block, never to see children that they bared ever again, to be hung from lynching trees and whipped on whipping posts. Yet in still, this heritage of people dig down deep inside of themselves and remembered that God was on their side. This Isaiah text teaches us more than anything. Isaiah was sharing with the people that they come from a heritage. What you talking about, Danielle? Well, let me explain. This Isaiah 54:17 text was written during a time when the children of Israel were in Babylonian exile. This means that they were not allowed to be together and worship together and fellowship together face to face. Let me make this clear. Somebody's gonna catch this. During Babylonian exile, they found themselves wrestling with brutality from Babylonian police departments, brutality from Babylonian law enforcement, brutality because of their culture, because of their race, because of their ethnicity, because of their color of their skin. They found themselves now living in a pandemic of Babylonian brutality. And then they were forced, because of their exile, because of their race, they were forced to social distance, not be around each other, not fellowship together. You think this is the first time in the history of the world that you have had to social distance? No. No, the children of Israel had to social distance from one another during Babylonian exile. And so the prophet Isaiah is stating these words in this 54th chapter as a reminder to the people who are suffering in two pandemics of exile and police brutality. You have to remember where you came from. Remember your heritage. What was the children of Israel's heritage? The children of Israel's heritage was when they were enslaved in Egypt years ago. Isaiah is reminding the people who are in Babylonian exile, remember what your grandmother and your grandfather had to bear when they were enslaved in Egypt just a few years ago by this nasty, mean ruler named Pharaoh. So in some sense, as we read this text today, in the midst of our pandemics of police brutality and COVID-19, because of white supremacy that has reared its ugly head in recent times yet again, we must be reminded of our heritage, reminded that we stand on the shoulders of a people who have went before us. How dare you feel like you need to throw in the towel? How dare you feel as if you need to give up? How dare you feel as if all hope is lost when there was a grandmother who prayed for you before you were even born? There was a grandfather who petitioned the throne of grace on your behalf before you were even born and traveled a stony road so that your path years later would be a little easy. Oh, this Isaiah text is telling us to remember the heritage that we come from. Remember that you had mothers and fathers and grandmothers and grandfathers and aunties and uncles who have paved the way for you. So you may be dangling on the edge of despair. You may feel as if all hope is gone. But brothers and sisters, remember, not only shall weapons be formed against you, not only shall tongues rise up to challenge you. Oh, but remember, you come from a heritage that is rooting for you. You come from African ancestors who are shouting, keep going, don't give up, you can do this. Remember, you have a grandmother that's somewhere in heaven, petitioning on your behalf and whispering, daughter, stay in the race. Son, don't give up. Remember your heritage of what your grandmother and grandfather used to say. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Whenever weapons rise up and tongues rise up, remember you have a heritage that has said, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. When weapons rise up against you and tongues rise up against you, remember, you have a heritage that has instilled in you, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? When weapons and tongues rise up against you, remember you have a heritage that has instilled in you. Who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? When weapons and tongues rise up against you, remember, you have a heritage that says to you, oh, for I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For your sake, we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. Oh, but family, know that God is with you in your situation. No matter what you wrestle with, no matter all of your challenges of dealings with weapons and tongues, you have a heritage that has went before you. May you stay encouraged on today and hang on just a little while longer. God bless you.
The Reverend Dr. Danielle Bahuro sure did preach a powerful word, didn't she? To God be the glory. Even though physical, psychological, and spiritual weapons will be formed, the good news is they will not prosper. And what's the gooder news? Yes, I said gooder. Well, that's that the weapons we form against ourselves will not prosper either. you might experience difficulty. You might experience defeat. Tongues may rise up against you. Voices may tell you that you are nothing and that you are not worthy. But you will be vindicated. You will survive and you will be a conqueror. For nothing will separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah, saints. God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. Hallelujah. Greetings, my sisters and brothers. I'm Reverend Gina Sorella Smith. Are you seeking salvation? Are you seeking a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? If so, I invite you to pray with me. Dear God, thank you for your son's sacrifice on the cross. Please forgive me and come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior and direct my path to your glory. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer with me, then rejoice, for you are now a part of the body of Christ. And you will know truly that Jesus is a waymaker, a miracle worker, and a promise keeper. Friends, if you do not have a church home or you're not growing where you're going, we indeed encourage you to connect to a faith community where you are spiritually led to fulfill God's plan for your life. We will be honored if you choose our faith community here at Trinity United Church of Christ Gary, where we seek to worship God and serve God's people. We invite you to dial the number on the screen, 219-944-0500. And we would be so pleased to welcome you into the family of Trinity United Church of Christ Gary. Join me in the benediction. Saints, the Lord is for you and not against you. Christ has not left you, nor will he leave you. The Holy Spirit is with you to comfort and guide you. Whatever trials you go through this week, go forward knowing that no weapon formed against you will prosper. For God is your defender, and vindication is from the Lord. God be with you. Amen.